Welcome back to the Hidden Structures Bootcamp series. In this video, we're going to look at 6-card packets. So packets of only 6 cards. So because we're back to even size packets, many of these important mathematical principles listed on the left will apply. Okay, so let's take a look. What happens in the realm of hidden structures, that's the top category here, when we have 6 cards? Well, as a quick review, let's look at what 2 cycles would look like. Remember, a 2-cycle is a structure where you have a repeating pattern and it occurs twice. So 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So a simple example of that with a packet of cards, of course, would be something like this. Ace, 2, 3. Now, we're not so interested in the colors or the suits. It's really just the values that are of interest to us right now. Okay, so that is a 2-cycle with cycle length 3. Because within each cycle, here's a cycle and here's a cycle, we have 3 elements. Okay, now a mirrored structure involving 6 cards is simply, in fact, we can use some of the principles we learned last time. How can we go from a 2-cycle to a mirrored structure? The simplest way is to perform a 50% coding of the cards. So maybe we'll do it that way this time. So what I need to do is just count out half of them, 50%, which is 3 cards out of 6, drop the rest on top. That will always convert a 2-cycle to a mirrored structure, and we can see that it's mirrored. Ace 2, 3, 3, 2, ace. That is a mirrored structure. The last structure type is an AMP. And I believe we also showed you a way to go from a mirrored to an AMP. We can perform an alternate Klondike, as listed over here. Now, technically, I can show you over here on this diagram, a regular just Klondike shuffle does the job. And if you think about what the alternate Klondike is doing, a Klondike shuffle can be used to accomplish this same result. So if I just take this mirrored structure and perform a Klondike, so I'm going to take off the top and bottom as 1, top and bottom as 1, top and bottom as 1, this will now be an AMP, adjacent mirrored pair structure. So I have 2 threes, 2 twos, and 2 aces. Now, as I've mentioned earlier, these sets of pairs, it doesn't matter what order they are in. So what I have here with 2 threes, 2 twos, 2 ones, this is just as good of an AMP structure involving these cards as the one perhaps listed here. So this is an AMP structure. Okay, so it will be helpful to also be able to go from an AMP, this kind of structure, back to a 2-cycle structure. Okay, now I just realized that I have to be a little bit careful with what I've told you in the past. Remember, let me point out over here on the left-hand side of your screen, this alternate Klondike will cycle you through all of these structure types. 2-cycle, mirrored, AMP. In fact, let me just move this piece of paper to kind of remind you of that. So here is that little cheat sheet, I guess. But if you notice, I have a blue filled in box here. Next to that, a K for alternate Klondike, there is a small 4N in blue. Now that might be hard for you to see on the screen, but what that indicates is we will need to have 4N cards, a multiple of 4 cards, to actually complete an entire cycle like this, okay? So with some of these, there are some restrictions. The blue ones require a multiple of 4 cards, and way down here, there's a couple of green ones that require a multiple of 8 cards. Okay? But going back to what I mentioned here, we were at just a mirrored, and then we came down to an AMP by performing a Klondike shuffle. There's no restriction. That will always work for any even size packet. As long as you start with a mirrored structure, you will end up with an AMP structure. Okay? Now, what I wanted to show you is how do we go from an AMP structure up to a 2-cycle? Well, the most common way of doing it is to perform an LR shuffle with random stacking. So here we are, an AMP going up to a 2-cycle. So let me just show you that that indeed is the case. An AMP structure now, if I perform a left-right dealing of the cards with random stacking, I will get a 2-cycle structure. Okay, so I have an ace-2-3. That is a 2-cycle structure. Okay, so maybe just to review with a 2-cycle structure such as this one, we can go from here to here by performing a 50% coding. That would be one way to do it. To go from here down to here, one way to accomplish that is to perform a Klondike shuffle, like that. And then to go from an AMP structure to a 2-cycle, the most common way is to perform an LR shuffle with random stacking. Isn't that nice that we can randomly stack those and it doesn't undermine that structure? In fact, really, with everything that we will do in this boot camp course and just about everything in the Hidden Structures online course, when there is an option for stacking left to right or right to left, it won't matter. Okay? And that is evidence of the symmetry of the structures that we're studying, that it won't matter whether you stack from left to right or right to left. You will get what you're hoping to get out of that procedure. So I wanted to just quickly show you that, how we go from these different structure types. In fact, I was going to write on this. Maybe that's going to restrict things too much because there's a number of ways of moving around and I don't want to give the impression that there's just one, because there are many ways to go between these structure types as well as to stay within a given structure type, as we will see today. So, as we have been doing, we've been kind of picking and choosing a few principles to look at during each of these videos, with the hope that as we go through all of the videos in this series, we will have talked about each and every one of these important mathematical principles. So I think what I'm going to do right now is introduce you to a wonderful magician in general. He's done a lot with cards. He's done a lot of different kinds of magic over the years. His stage name is Max Maven. His real name is Phil Goldstein or Goldstein. And I wanted to point you to another book that is worth picking up. Now, unfortunately, this particular book is out of print, but there are still plenty of used copies that can be purchased on Amazon and other places. It's a short little book, but boy, it's packed full of some incredibly clever routines and ways of using principles that I will be teaching you. Now, Max Maven, here's my copy of it. Max Maven is not a mathematician. And so this fascinating principle he talks about, it's a marriage between the stay stack principle and the lone survivor principle. Okay? Now, I don't believe he even mentions that here in the book, But he has latched on to this wonderful marriage of these two powerful interacting procedures and has created a book full of engaging narratives and fun routines that you can go through that are very, very surprising. And the spectators just love watching these and experiencing the magic that he has put together here. So he's quite a mastermind coming up with wonderful routines that exploit the synergy of these two properties, these two procedures. Okay? So on my diagram earlier, let me just click on it here. I have Max Maven, okay? And I put it under our hidden structures diagram because it ends up that the structures that he uses are mirrored structures, coupled structures, and then together with that, he uses the lone survivor principle. Now, he doesn't explain why they work or how they work, and quite honestly, very few people would know actually how or why they work. Once you've gone through this boot camp course, you'll know why they work. And if you go through the Hidden Structures course, you will certainly know very well what drives all of the effects in the book written by Phil Goldstein there. Okay, and then down here, which I'm going to show you in a minute, is something I call Max Maven's card variations. So here, Max Maven 5-card variation. So what I've done is I've taken his original kind of procedure or narrative, I guess, his original construction of the routine, and then applying additional principles that I'm teaching you here and that are included in the Hidden Structures online course, we can do some additional things that go beyond what is in that redivider book that I just showed you. Okay, so enough talking. Let's do some of this right now. Okay, now let me see here. I might, just for a moment, so hang on to that hope that we're going to look at some of these fun results by Max Maven. I wanted to quickly do something with you that would kind of show you the simple value of knowing the structure type for something. Okay, so what I have here is I have, in fact, it's this packet. Excuse me, I grabbed the wrong packet. That one I just showed you we'll need in a minute as well. Okay, so here's a packet of 6 cards, okay? And if you look at those, certainly quickly, you probably won't see any structure to them at all, I would imagine. So I'm going to now close them up for just a second. And I'm going to go ahead and do some of the mixing procedures that you've seen already. Now, one you haven't seen is the Charlier Shuffle. Now, for anyone familiar with my channel, you know how this works. You push off a number of cards from the top, then from the bottom you push off a number and put them on top, and then some of these cards go on the bottom, and then maybe this last card goes on top. So the repeating phrase is top to bottom, bottom to top, top to bottom, bottom to top. So we push off maybe 2. There aren't very many cards here, so it's actually hard to demonstrate the Charlier Shuffle. Maybe I push off 1 there, maybe 2 here, and then 1 here. So top goes into my left hand, some on the bottom go on top, some of the top here go on the bottom, some of the bottom here go on top. Okay. Now, I do have a separate video called the Charlier Shuffle. It's on the Hidden Structures channel, and I very carefully go through how to perform the Charlier Shuffle. And I show you what properties it has. What does it accomplish? And I'll mention some of the punchlines in just a second, but you may want to look that up if that went too fast. Or equally possible, because we only have six cards, it's kind of hard to see what's going on with the Charlier Shuffle. So maybe watch that video. So what I've done is I've kind of mixed these up, right? In the minds of really any spectator, no one would know what that top card is, and that's true, unless I was somehow tracking those, and I wasn't. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to just count out half the cards, put those down like that. I could have allowed random stacking of these, by the way, and I should have given you or the spectator the choice to do that. I can now go ahead and perform a Klondike Shuffle. And then I can actually do an LR Shuffle. And here I can give the spectator the choice. Would you like the left on the right or the right on the left? Maybe they want the right pile on top of the left. Now, with our diagram, I want to emphasize that we could mix this little packet of cards for the next week without stopping, using all of these different ways of moving about these structure types or staying within a certain structure type. We really could. And within many of these shuffles, you are giving the spectator choices on how to do things. They are playing a crucial role in all of it, okay? But to avoid doing too much with this quick little example at the beginning, what I want to do now is, I've mixed this up and given you some choices as to what to do with the packets along the way. And now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to put the pack, deal out the cards into three piles, as so, okay? Now, I'm going to try to sense what the cards are, what has happened here. And the feeling I'm getting is, amazingly, we were able to separate these cards by suit. Despite their messy order at the beginning, the Charlier Shuffle, I was moving cards around without even really paying attention. I performed a 50% coding in which I could have given you the option to stack left on right and right on left. I did a Klondike, and then I did a left-right deal in which you decided how to stack those. I'm just feeling like each suit has found its partner. Oh, okay. We have two hearts. Two clubs. And two spades. We did indeed separate these by suit. Okay, so let's just quickly kind of show you what was done there and how it relates to what you're beginning to learn in this series. So what I had at the beginning is I had them sort of in chased order, but I don't have all four suits here. So I just did, this wasn't the exact order, by the way, but club, heart, spades. And then I repeated club, heart, spades. Okay, well, what kind of structure is this? Well, focus on the fact that we are only interested at the moment on suits. That's kind of interesting because so far in this series, we focused on values, right? The value of the card. Well, there's no reason for you to focus just on value. You could focus on value or color or suit or a whole bunch of other things, as we'll see moving forward. So if you focus on suits, is this not a two-cycle structure with cycle length 3? A club, a heart, a spade. That's the first cycle. A club, a heart, a spade. A second cycle. This is a two-cycle. Perfectly fine two-cycle. Well, what did I do? I came over here. If you look down at the bottom, these are shuffles that leave two cycles alone. So if you start with a two cycle, you end with a two cycle. So what I did was the Charlier Shuffle, which is a very convincing little shuffle. It is certainly one worth mastering. And it doesn't take very long before you can do that without looking and without any mistakes. Okay, so I mixed that. I was doing this sort of thing, right? Just top to bottom, bottom to top, top to bottom to top. That's the Charlier. And so that will preserve the two-cycle structure. Now, notice once again, cards are moving around. Cards are changing position. They truly are. But structure is being preserved because I still have a two-cycle here. I have a heart, now a spade, now a club. A heart, a spade, and a club. Okay, so this is still a two-cycle. I haven't undermined that fact. Now, what I did from there, if you recall, I did a 50% coating of the cards, and I should have or can give the spectator the choice to stack these however they like. So maybe they stack it in this order. That's just fine. This will now be a mirrored structure. We saw this in a previous video. Mirrored. Well, how do we know it's mirrored? The outer cards are of the same category, namely of the same suit. Come in one, they're both spades. Come into the middle, they're both hearts. This is mirrored. We went from a mirrored to an AMP. Well, to do that, one way to do it, as I pointed out over here, if you can see the moving mouse, is the very top one, K, Klondike, will take you from a mirrored structure to an AMP. So I just did a Klondike shuffle. This is where you take the top and bottom cards off as one and then stack those until you're finished. This will now be an AMP. Okay, so what's an AMP? This is where the cards of interest are in pairs. And so the cards of interest are those of the same suit. I have two hearts, spades, clubs. Okay, now to get back to a two cycle, you may recall the final shuffle that I did to do that was an LR shuffle. So come over here in the diagram, LR will take us from an AMP up to a two-cycle structure. So we can go left, right, left, right, left, right with random stacking decided by the spectator. This will now be a two-cycle. It is not in any way the same exact ordering of the original cards. I mean, look at this. This is a club, now it's a spade, and then a heart. Club, spade, and heart. Okay. Well, just think about what I did for the final step. I took this packet that had been mixed, quite a bit, and we could have mixed it much more. I simply dealt out the cards into three piles. What does that do to a two cycle with cycle length 3? Think about it. What have I just done? Well, technically, I've done something called an LR inverse. But what we're doing here is we are just putting back together the cards of the same suit. That is what we are doing. And so that's why I was able to finish the way I did, because I knew it was a two cycle with cycle length 3. Being of cycle length 3, dealing out those cards, 1, 2, 3, and then 1, 2, 3, I will pair up cards of the same category. And the category of interest here is suit. We want cards of the same suit. Okay, so I wanted to just kind of quickly do that to show you a couple of other things on our big diagram here before we do some fun Max Maven magic. Okay, so click over here. Okay, so what I'm going to do is first demonstrate one of his performances, and you may not see, you probably won't be able to see exactly, okay, now how did we accomplish that, but we will. Oop, that's getting kind of bright there. Maybe I do actually like this piece of paper here, or some kind of piece of paper. throwing off the lighting. Okay, so what I have here, in fact, I'll just move this up out of the way, is I want to just show you that I have I have companion cards. They're called companion cards. In fact, this is some good vocabulary to get down at this point in the series. Companion cards are cards of the same value and the same color. So those are companion cards, those are companion cards, and these are companion cards, okay? So I just showed you that there's a partner for each one. That's really all I've done. Okay, now you'll recognize some of the steps here. Okay, I'm just gonna mix this up a little bit. Okay, and then I'm going to perform a Klondike shuffle to mix it further. And now, what we're going to try to do, if we can, is we're going to do some left-right dealing. And the object of this game, and I call it the Max Maven game, is to left-right deal these cards and be so lucky as to bring two cards of the same kind, the companion cards, up to the top. Okay? Well, those are not companion cards. So that would be a fail. So I failed. And you can randomly stack those or have the spectator decide how to stack those. Okay, let's see how we do here. Did we find the companion? No, we did not. Okay, now it ends up that because these are mirrored piles that I'm dealing out, and this is a principle we'll look at in detail throughout this series, these top cards, in fact, can never match. They will never match because of the structure of the packet. So you can deal those off left, right, and then reveal the top cards, and they'll never match. So what you do is you deal it off, you know, once you've convinced the spectator that, oh man, these things are never going to match, you deal them one more time. And so you say, well, choose either card on either top card. So for either pile, choose the top card. So maybe they choose this one. Okay? So we set it right there. In fact, you could set it face down if you like, or face up. I guess in some ways it doesn't really matter. And now what you need to do as the performer is you take the larger of the two piles and you just casually drop it on top. Okay, and pick up all the cards along the way. And now we're going to play this game of she loves me, she loves me not. Okay, so she loves me not. I'll just toss that to the side. She loves me not. Maybe I won't toss it to the side because we can point out something here. She loves me not. She loves me not. Ooh, how did we do? We found the companion card. Okay, so that is Max Maven's kind of basic routine. You're trying to get those top cards to match after a left-right deal, and then you have the spectator choose either one of the top cards, and then you kind of stack those two piles and perform that under-down deal. And the lone survivor for the under-down deal will always, always, always be the companion card to the one that was freely chosen by the spectator at the beginning, okay? Now, I point out something here, and so this will enable you to read the diagram now instead of having to wait until the hidden structures course. But if you come over here, and I may have to actually state it because it's kind of hard to read down here. Oh, in fact, it's over here. Okay, so I have A and P, four cards, plus one revealed pair. That's R pair. So if you remember, I had a revealed pair, these two. And what I'm telling you here is that this is an A and P. It will always be an AMP at the end of this routine. Always, always. Well, let's confirm that. Is that an AMP relative to value and color? It is indeed. Companion cards, companion cards. Well, what does that allow you to do if you know that this is an AMP? Well, if you just take these two cards, drop them on top, do we not have an AMP at this point? We do indeed. How can we go from here to there? Well, we just perform an LR shuffle. Okay, so it's cyclic now. It's a two cycle. What was one of the ways we got it to be mirrored? Well, a 50% coding always works. Okay, and then once it's here, this is where the packet needs to be before beginning a max maven routine. It needs to be mirrored. So the cards that are of the same category need to be on opposite ends as you come in. And so from this point, dealing these cards left, right, left, right, it gives us something called mirrored piles. Mirrored piles. What's a mirrored pile? A mirrored pile is that the top card here will be related to the bottom card there. Okay? And the second card there is related to the second card from the bottom, which happens to be also the second from the top because there's three in each. So these are mirrored piles. Well, it ends up that when you have mirrored piles performing a left, right, left, right, left, right shuffle, these two cards at the top will never, ever match. They'll never be of the same category that you've set up for those cards. Okay? So you would go through and do multiple LRs and show that, oh, we failed. We weren't able to get companion cards. And then when you're done, to enable a win, as Max Maven describes it, you just deal out left, right once again. Allow the spectator to choose either card. This time we can have it face down if you would like. And in the case of this five card, and in this case where we have five cards, the larger of the two is set on top and we perform our under down deal. She loves me, she loves me not, she loves me, she loves me not. Yes, no, yes, no, yes, she does. And so this should be the companion card for that one. Okay, and as you notice, it's almost like reset the whole thing because guess what? This is an AMP, and when you put those on top, you're back to a structure type that you know what to do with it and where you can take it, and you'll know where you've arrived after certain shuffles have been performed. Okay, that is the Max Maven six-card routine. It's one of the first ones he shows you in his book, Redivider. Now, what I want to point out here on our little chart is something called a Max Maven variation. Now, this will draw on principles that we have taught in previous videos in this series already. Okay, so here, here we have an AMP relative to value and color, right? Now, we need to get over here. We need it to be mirrored for the Max Maven routine to even work. Instead of going from here to a two cycle and from a two cycle to a mirrored, we can actually just go directly from an AMP to a mirrored. And there's a very, very nice shuffle that gets you there right away. So let me just show you that one. It's one that we really need to learn because it's one of the essential ones for the Hidden Structures course. So we're down here, we have an AMP. To get up to a mirrored structure, now don't be confused by the M. The M here is not for mirrored, it's for Monge, M-O-N-G-E. The Monge shuffle is also referred to as the over-under, under-over shuffle. Either one of those will work. So it will take an AMP structure and convert it to a mirrored structure. So let's go ahead and just show you that. So this is an AMP structure right now. Why don't we go ahead and do the under-over. So this is where you push off the top card, The next one here goes under, the next one goes over, the next one goes under, over, under. Okay, so that is a mon shuffle. It's an under, over. That will always convert, always, always, convert an AMP to a mirrored structure, which is the starting structure that we need for a Max Maven performance. And so you can see that this is mirrored relative to card value and color. Okay? So for this variation, much of the beginning is the same. You go ahead and do, or have the spectator do this left-right shuffle. The goal is to try to get those to match and just see if how lucky you are as a person. Because, you know, maybe if you just stack them in the right way, you're going to get it this next time. And what you'll see, of course, is that they'll never match, right? And it's because they're mirrored piles, okay? So from here, you say, wow, that's not working. Let's put them out one more time again and try something different. Go ahead and choose the top card of either one of these piles. And so maybe they choose this one here, so that this is all the same as a regular Max Maven routine. As before, take the pile of three, put them on top like that, okay? But you have to kind of think through what the middle card will be. What will the middle card be in this new packet? Will it have any relationship with that one? Well, think about it. So it came from here. Let's kind of go back in time here. So they chose this one. Now, maybe even go back further in time. To what card is this one related if the piles are mirrored? Well, this card is related to the bottom one here, right? They have this mirrored relationship. So if the spectator puts this one down, and then you set these three on top, where this is the other nine, then their special companion card will be in that middle position. So why do we like the middle position of odd-sized packets? Because they're predictable. When it comes to odd-sized packets, we haven't seen all of this yet, but we will. There's three special cards or three special positions in any odd-sized list of things or odd-sized packet. It is the top card, the bottom card, and the middle card. Those are three very important positions within an odd length sequence of elements. Okay, so right now we're interested in that middle one. Well, what did we show you last time? What is one fun way to kind of reveal the middle card? Well, you perform the Klondike shuffle, right? Well, and we'll do that in a second. But if you perform the, well, why don't we go ahead and we'll just do it. If you perform the Klondike shuffle, this card here will be the mirrored mate to that one, guaranteed. Now, the reason I hesitated a moment ago is we had a five-card packet. That one was in the middle. We could have performed a number of overcodings. Remember, where you count out more than 50% of the cards, put them to the table, drop the rest on top. If you remember, that leaves the middle card in the middle position. So if their name happened to have, five or fewer letters in their name, their name was John, you could spell J-O-H-N, put the remaining card on top, and that would have left our special card in the middle, so that when we did this Klondike shuffle, we would have finished just the way we did here. So you can tie in a number of things that we've shown you already, but I do want to point out that if we go back to our little table here for the card Max Maven variations, I do point out what structure you'll have at the end of this, where we did this Klondike reveal of that middle card. So what this particular performance will give you It will once again give you an AMP here. So this says AMP, four cards, and one revealed pair, just as in the original performance. So what this means is, this is a very nice structure right now. It's an AMP, so that if we were to just put these cards on top, we're back to the beginning. We haven't really lost track of where we are, okay? And so I can actually, from here, go ahead and show you the other variation, and we'll probably call it good for this video, because it's probably getting too long. So here I have an AMP, and I just showed you a wonderful way to go from here to here. It's the Mon shuffle. That can be the over-under, repeated, or under-over. Well, I've already used the under-over for the first one, so why don't we do an over-under? So how this works is you push off the top card. Now before, I put this card under, but we're going to do over first. Over, under, over, under, over. This will always, always convert an AMP to a mirrored structure, okay? So now we're back to the beginning where we need to be. We need a mirrored structure for the Max Maven routines. These cards will never match to the frustration and perhaps surprise of the spectator. And then you would simply deal them out one more time. Allow a free choice here. It really is pretty surprising that if they don't choose the right one or something, the whole thing falls apart. It doesn't matter because of symmetry. So they can choose this one this time if they would like. And we could even reveal it this time if you would prefer or they would prefer. And then just casually drop those on top. And so instead of doing an under over and revealing the middle card, or instead of doing the Klondike shuffle to reveal the middle card, what we can do is something we showed you last time. We can do the LR deal. You remember that? So this is where you go one, you just deal it into two piles. You retain the odd size pile, the larger, it'll always be the larger pile. Set these aside for now. Do the same thing again. And now we have reached a single card. What are the chances that this is the companion card? Well, if we actually calculate the probability that it is by chance alone, it's fairly small. But for us, we know it's 100% because of the structure of the packets that we're working with. And we know what these different shuffles are going to do to these various structure types. Now, finally, over here, I also point out that these pairs that we've just dealt, I say here, see, I have one pair plus one pair plus one revealed pair. So these all match. These will also be companion pairs. So you could reveal that as a kind of an additional finale to the whole thing, that not only did you match the one that was freely chosen by them, in the end, you were able to match up all of them, despite their choices and their agency in this whole process, okay? So anyway, that's probably enough for today. So we're very slowly kind of working our way through these various mathematical principles. And so next time, we're going to be back to odd size packets. We're going to look at 7-card packets and see what surprising things we can do with just 7 cards. So I hope to see you then.